From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice. Here's your host.
Hello, and welcome to our listeners around the world. You're listening to the JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. Thanks for being here. I am Dr. David Simel, JAMA Associate Editor and Professor Emeritus of Medicine at the Durham Veterans Affairs Medical Center and Duke University. In this podcast, we will be discussing vitamin D for the prevention of disease. I'm joined today by Dr. Sherri-Ann Burnett-Bowie, who is an Associate Professor of Medicine at Harvard Medical School. Dr. Burnett-Bowie is an author of our Clinical Guidelines Synopsis on Vitamin D in the April 23, 2025 edition of JAMA. Dr. Burnett-Bowie, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you so much, Dr. Simel.
Let's start our discussion today at a very basic level with the definition of a vitamin and whether vitamin D is a vitamin or something else.
So a vitamin is something that our bodies cannot make. Vitamin D can actually be made in our skin if we have enough exposure to sunlight and we actually are unclothed enough to be able to make that vitamin. So vitamin D, I would categorize as something else because between our exposure outside, how much clothing we're wearing, whether we're using sunscreen or not, most of us do not get enough sunlight to be able to make vitamin D in our skin, and thus we are reliant on foods that either naturally have vitamin D or foods that are fortified with vitamin D or supplements.
Well, which foods are the natural sources of vitamin D?
So foods that are natural sources of vitamin D include the skin of fatty fish like trout, salmon, tuna, mackerel, fish liver oils. And then, relatively speaking, there's a far smaller amount of vitamin D naturally in eggs. So by way of example, in 3 ounces of trout, there are 645 international units of vitamin D. For the duration of the conversation, I will be using international units. However, if you are one of our listeners who uses micrograms, the conversion from international units to micrograms is by dividing the international units number by 40. So while 3 ounces of salmon contain 570 units of vitamin D, one large egg has 44 international units of vitamin D. White mushrooms exposed to UV light, a half cup, will contain approximately 400 international units of vitamin D. And then fortified milk or any of the non-animal-based milks like soy, almond, oat milk, they are also fortified and they contain roughly about 120 international units of vitamin D. Foods that are made from milk, like cheese or yogurt, are typically not fortified with vitamin D.
Well, in addition to getting vitamin D from sun exposure and the natural food sources and the fortified food sources, many people seem to just empirically be taking vitamin D supplements. Are there any adverse effects from supplemental vitamin D?
So the recommended upper daily allowance in health, again, based on the recommendations in the United States, is 4,000 international units daily. If you're under care and you're being recommended to consume a different amount, then that's a distinct situation. But the recommended daily upper intake is 4,000 units in health. The greatest concern in terms of a complication of taking too much vitamin D is that you will have increased absorption of calcium that you may be consuming either from your diet or from supplements. And that increased absorption of calcium will lead to either elevated blood calcium levels or to kidney stones. For most people, this is very unusual, but those are the potential complications of taking too much vitamin D.
Well, while all of us recognize the role of vitamin D in skeletal metabolism and mineral homeostasis, this particular guideline looked at vitamin D for the prevention of other types of diseases in healthy children, adolescents, and adults. And the guidelines evaluated vitamin D in healthy children for lowering the rate of respiratory infections, in adults 75 and over for lowering mortality, and in those with prediabetes for decreasing the progression to diabetes. I'd like to go over each of these. Can you review for us the basis for the suggestion of vitamin D supplementation to lower the risk of respiratory infection in children age 1 to 18?
When we think about vitamin D, we think about it normally being metabolized from 25-hydroxyvitamin D, which we measure clinically to assess vitamin D stores, that it is then hydroxylated in the kidney to form 1,25-dihydroxyvitamin D, which is the activated form of vitamin D that does all of the different important functions in the body. Very interestingly, macrophages, very key immune cells, contain that 1-alpha-hydroxylase that takes vitamin D from the dietary measure 25-hydroxyvitamin D to the activated measure 1,25-dihydroxyvitamin D. So this is really key, this idea that our immune systems require a certain amount of vitamin D to facilitate immune function. What that amount is, it's not clear. But this may be one of the reasons for what was observed, which was vitamin D in children was associated with a decreased risk of respiratory tract infections, and in particular, pneumonias. This impact on pneumonia is very important because in children under the age of 5, pneumonia is the leading infectious disease cause of death. Secondly, tuberculosis is a major cause of morbidity and mortality in children. And that activation to the active form of vitamin D in macrophages, that is really key to creating cathelicidin, which is a key factor in our cells that kills tuberculosis. So the pathway to vitamin D having supplementation in children to prevent infection is one of the clearer ones, and it really has to do with what's occurring in the immune system in generating this activated vitamin D moiety.
You say the pathway is clear, but the effect was actually rather small.
Yes. So the effect in terms of respiratory infection did include, in terms of the confidence interval, the potential of zero effect. Zero was included. The consensus panel recommended empiric treatment still with supplemental vitamin D in children because of the concern of comorbidity and mortality related to low vitamin D and infection. And then secondly, because of the inexpensiveness of taking a vitamin D supplement and also the expense related to testing and the healthcare associated with being tested. So while there may have been a small demonstrated impact with the potential for there to be a null effect because zero was included in the confidence interval, because of the epidemiologic data that exists, because of the physiology, which truthfully was not necessarily included in the guideline, but it's something that has been discussed by many people who do vitamin D research. Ultimately, the recommendation was made for children. In addition, because there is a potential for rickets and the impact on musculoskeletal health, that was again another reason for supplementing children with vitamin D empirically without measuring their 25-hydroxyvitamin D levels.
So the recommendation from the Society for Children aged 1 to 18 was to take supplemental vitamin D to achieve a small effect. And there actually may be no effect if you look at the results. But what about the decrease in mortality for those 75 and older. How strong was that effect?
For the individuals who are ages 75 and older, that was when there was a recommendation for additional empiric vitamin D. The effect, once again, with regard to mortality in that particular age range did include zero. So there is the possibility of no effect. However, in terms of what was observed, they observed that there was a reduction in death of approximately 6% with vitamin D supplementation of 900 international units. That would have been in addition to the recommended daily intake of 800 units.
Well, we all recognize the very high prevalence of prediabetes. And for those affected patients, the guidelines suggest that additional vitamin D might decrease the risk of progression to diabetes. How much vitamin D was used in the clinical trials that evaluated prediabetes, and what were the effects from those trials?
The challenge with these analyses were that the vitamin D dose actually varied across the different studies. There were 10 randomized clinical trials that were studied. In addition to the vitamin D dose varying, the duration of the studies varied from 6 months to 60 months. What they observed was that taking approximately an average weighted daily dose of vitamin D that accounted for the differences in doses and the differences in duration, but an average weighted daily dose of 3,500 units of vitamin D resulted in 2.4% fewer individuals progressing from prediabetes to diabetes. Again, the confidence interval did abut zero, so there is the potential for there to have been no effect, but on average, the risk difference was 2.4% fewer people developing diabetes from prediabetes.
So to put that dose in perspective, I believe you said that the recommended daily intake for adults over age 70 would be, what, somewhere around 800 international units, 600 to 800 international units. And in these trials that were summed up in the meta-analysis, the average dose was 3,500 units.
That is correct.
And then once again, we have an effect that maybe could be important if it's real, but there's a possibility of no effect.
Correct.
Well, the guidelines suggest not screening healthy children and adults with serum 25-hydroxy vitamin D levels to either guide decision-making about whether to take a supplement or to guide dosing in those taking supplements. What are the pros and cons of using serum levels in healthy persons?
So the challenge is that, and this was discussed in the guideline development panel could not find clinical trial evidence that would support establishing distinct 25-hydroxy vitamin D thresholds that would be tied to specific outcome or benefits in the populations that were studied. And in addition, the guideline development panel no longer recommends or endorses that a certain 25-hydroxy vitamin D defines vitamin D sufficiency, insufficiency, deficiency. This was different from their prior recommendations. And because of those challenges and the fact that vitamin D is inexpensive, taking vitamin D supplementation translates into about a cost of $10 to $50 per year. Contrast that with the cost then of having your vitamin D level measured. That is at least $25 to $100 per test, and that does not account for the other healthcare costs associated with having blood work done, nor challenges with some of the accuracy of measurement of vitamin D, nor the fact that there may not be access to vitamin D measurements. So all of that together led the panel with what I mentioned earlier, that vitamin D is typically safe to be consumed with few side effects, for them to recommend against screening with 25-hydroxyvitamin D to determine who should be supplemented or not.
In thinking about vitamin D supplementation and the implementation of these guidelines, are there other things you would like our listeners to know or information that they could convey to their patients?
I think the main consideration that I would really stress, these guidelines, this update relates to patients who are healthy, and it does not apply to patients who have certain diseases that might impact their vitamin D metabolism, nor does it pertain to patients who have diseases that having vitamin D levels that are quote unquote normal, it would be important for them. So if your patient has advanced kidney disease, if they have malabsorption, if they are at risk for low vitamin D levels because of either their diet, being vegetarian, being lactose intolerant, being breastfed, or if they are on certain medications that might increase the metabolism of vitamin D, those are patients who you should screen with 25-hydroxyvitamin D. If your patient has hypocalcemia, low calcium levels, prior fragility fractures or osteoporosis, again, you should be screening them with vitamin D levels and ensuring that they are at least 20 nanograms per ml. And based on other clinical parameters, whether that patient has hyperparathyroidism, by way of example, you might desire a higher 25-hydroxyvitamin D level. But the key thing is that these recommendations are for patients who are healthy, and they are for the prevention of disease.
Well, thank you, Dr. Burnett-Bowie, for joining us today to talk about vitamin D supplementation in healthy children and adults. I am Dr. David Simel. This episode was produced by Shelley Steffens at the JAMA Network. You can find a link to this manuscript in the episode show notes. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at JAMA Network Audio, all one word, .com, or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcast. Thanks for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.